Okay, this is the Injury Prevention Committee of the Governor's EMS and Trauma Advisory Council. Marianne, will you call roll, please?
Got it. Shelley?
Present.
Susan?
Present.
Birchfield? Marianne Contreras? I'm present. Wayne Dennis? Courtney Edwards?
Present.
Linda Galvan? Oh, excuse me, she resigned. Sorry. Jessica LaPlante? And Stuart Williams?
Present.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I want to start out by many of you may have known Crystal Beasley when she was worked for the State Health Department in the Trauma Registry and Program. And just wanted to start out by, and many of you may already know that she passed away after a complicated battle with leukemia and complications from a stem cell transplant. Crystal was a real friend to injury prevention in Texas, and particularly injury epidemiology. And for those who knew her, you all knew what a vivacious, lively, beautiful person she was inside and out. And so we're certainly going to miss Crystal in the injury and violence prevention community. And if you all would just keep Stuart and Crystal's family in your thoughts and prayers, I know that they would appreciate that. Let's move on to agenda items. And Courtney, you want to talk about TTCF and TTAF?
So TTCF's Injury Prevention Committee met on Tuesday. What they discussed was TTAF's statewide campaign with the Just Drive campaign. There are additional resources that are being placed on the TTAF website for a letter to your school principal about the program, a guidance letter also to Commerce, your Bureau of Commerce in your city about the program, and some timelines about some goals that they're trying to reach for September. In September, a week is going to be dedicated towards taking the drive, not to drive distracted in your vehicle. And so there's some buildup of things that you can do in your community that you can pull from that website and implement. So TTAF reviewed some of those changes. They're also going down the route of bumper stickers and things that can be used as part of the program at the local level that they can hand out, where they can implement that and also build that. So gearing up towards the week of pledges, that way it allows people to have the flexibility as to, you know, what if that school will let you in, maybe not on a Tuesday but on a Wednesday, and you're not trying to meet the day. So that's where TTCF and TTAF are working. TTAF is also planning on doing the TIPS symposium, so the Trauma Injury Prevention Symposium. They're planning on in February, the Monday before the meetings, so that way the morning sessions will be more structure about how to implement injury prevention programs, concepts that can be useful for that. And then the afternoon is going to be a demonstration of different programs that are already in place. There is a unintended pedestrian as one of the presentations in the afternoon, also a distracted driving presentation, and also one towards abusive head trauma in children, are three that have already tentatively confirmed for that. So that will be coming. And one of the things that is on the plate for that TIPS symposium is one of the things that we're going to talk about later with the hospital-based injury prevention components.
Okay, thanks, Courtney. Have dates been set for the next 2015 GETAC meetings?
I have not heard dates. The last I've heard is that the requests have been out for bids for hotel spaces and that kind of thing.
That's correct, yeah.
Okay. And then the other question I had is, I had a call last week from someone with the who works for the National Safety Council but is based in Texas. They have a program called Drive at Home that I was just learning about, and it's kind of a parent-led team driving type program. I don't know if anyone has heard of it, or and if they had been in contact with my understanding is that there are five sites in Texas where they're implementing, and I didn't know if I have a meeting with them next week to find out more about it, but I didn't know if they had been in touch with anyone from TTAP, TTCF, or anyone in the audience had any dealings with the Drive at Home program, or okay, we'll find out more about it then. Okay. All right. We also excited to have on the agenda today folks from the Texas Children's Hospital Association, who have during the last year undertaken a study of, I guess, injury and violence prevention activities within the state. I think that Brian and Aaron will probably talk about the what precipitated the study, what they found, and things like that. But I know that there's been a lot of discussion about there are a lot of activities, injury and violence prevention activities going on in Texas. A lot of good things, but they're not necessarily coordinated. And I think that one of the things that is going to come out of this report, and I don't want to steal your thunder or anything, is that the need for more coordination of activities. And I know you guys focus predominantly on children's activities and things like that, but we're excited to hear about the study and your findings. And this is Brian Sperry and Aaron McManus.
Well, thank you.
It should be on. Okay. It's on. You might just bring it closer to
My name's Brian Sperry, and I'm the president of the Children's Hospital Association of Texas. We're a state advocacy organization that represents the not-for-profit children's hospitals, freestanding children's hospitals in Texas. CHAT's been in existence for about 20 years. We have eight members: Dell, Driscoll, Children's Medical Center Dallas, Cook, Covenant out in Lubbock, Texas Children's Hospital, Children's Hospital of San Antonio in El Paso. You should be glad I'm not from THA, because I'd still be reading this. We were formed as an organization to really advocate on behalf of children's health and children's hospitals years ago, with a primary focus initially on the Medicaid program and children with special health care needs, because children's hospitals were so dependent on those programs. But over the years, we've evolved to have some broader public policy goals, which are to keep kids healthy, to cover kids, make sure they've got insurance coverage, and to build a high-quality pediatric health care system. And over the years, historically, we've done some work with the LBJ School of Public Affairs. Professor Dave Warner has been very good at identifying very good students, and we've done some studies in the past on issues like children's mental health, child abuse, and disaster preparedness. This past year, we were very happy to have Aaron McManus, who was finishing up her first year at the LBJ School and has worked for state government and is now at the LBB this summer, so to take on a project in looking at the state of injury prevention in Texas for us. You know, why injury prevention at this point for us? Well, again, historically, we've been involved in a number of statewide advocacy efforts. We worked for a number of sessions on the statewide bicycle helmet legislation sponsored by Representative Carter, which of course never really came to fruition. We spent three sessions working with the Pediatric Society and Chris Paul-Yuma, who many of you know, working on booster seat legislation, which was successful. We've worked on texting while driving as part of a larger coalition for the last couple of sessions. And we've worked with disparate groups over the year on injury prevention. You know, children's hospitals, as they went through the trauma designation process, have evolved pretty strong injury prevention programs at individual hospitals. Pediatric Society has an injury prevention committee that's strong. We've had growing interest in children's hospitals around abusive head trauma and child abuse issues, which is showing up more and more as a problem. Of course, we've worked with the Child Fatality Review Team. There have been groups that have reached out to us as well, drowning prevention groups locally, asking what's going on at the statewide level. And with the, you know, focus, a lot of attention to child deaths related to the CPS system, some of the issues are really broader than child abuse issues, their basic injury prevention issues. And with the sunset process underway this year, where the responsibilities of Health and Human Services agencies are being looked at broadly, and there's potential for some refocusing of responsibilities this session, it made sense to try to commission a study, which Aaron did, to kind of give us a better sense of the state of the state, because it was really hard to get our arms around all the things that were going on. So with some general guidance, we asked Aaron to talk to key informants around the state and gather what she could and draw us a picture of injury prevention in Texas. So I think she did a terrific job, and gonna let her present some of the highlights of the report.
Sure, I can. Like Brian said, my name is Erin McManus. I'm a student over at the LBJ School of Public Affairs. Like you said, I also worked in state government before returning to school, and I'm there again this summer. it's been a good experience. But I would like to go ahead and note as well that Paula Yuma was very much a guiding light on this report. She provided a lot of the structure and guidance for it as well, so it's as much hers as it is Brian's or my report. And I'll go ahead and just walk through basically some of the findings of the report and really just the sections. I know Brian's been circulating. Perfect, sorry. I'll go ahead and walk through what we found with the report. And I know many of you I've spoken to as well, and you've contributed to this report as well through interviews. And so really, the first section was to look at the prevalence of unintentional injuries. And most of that data is obviously gathered through the CDC. And there are approximately 12,000 children in the United States die from unintentional injuries. And nationally, motor vehicle incidents cause the greatest number of unintentional injury deaths in infants and children under 19 years of age. Within Texas, children under the age of 1 and between the ages of 15 and 19 have the highest rates of unintentional injuries, and those are due primarily to the motor vehicle accidents, also to suffocation deaths as well. Texas is above national averages for deaths in children under 19 years of age for drowning, poisoning, motor vehicle occupant injuries, and pedestrian injuries. Those were really the large areas where these injuries were occurring. The state does support quite a few different programs to address injuries. Unfortunately, those programs are not particularly centralized in any one agency. They're spread out, and so is the funding, as I'll discuss here in a couple minutes. TxDOT and DSHS operate the Safe Riders program. That's one of the largest state injury prevention programs. They provide booster seats and motor vehicle safety and educational materials. The Texas Office for the Prevention of Developmental Disabilities and DPS, they host a wide variety of bike rodeos and give away free bicycle helmets, and they do that throughout the state. DSHS and DFPS operate the Safe Sleep for Babies program. That's primarily been a training program. They've developed different training materials to give to health educators, checklists for parents, that sort of thing. And the Commission on State Emergency Communications manages the Poison Control Network. There are 6 hospitals in Texas that are designated as poison control centers. And in contrast to those, there are quite a few community programs that are operating within the state. There are 9 Safe Kids groups in Texas that work under the Safe Kids Worldwide Coalition, as well as the Kohl's Cares for Kids program, provides quite a bit of funding to hospitals in the state, as well as hospitals nationwide. And then, of course, the Injury Free Coalition. There are 2 injury free sites in Texas as well. And then some professional organizations also have programs, such as the Texas Medical Association. They have hard hats for little heads programs that I know many hospitals have used their matching program to purchase bicycle helmets for distribution. There's also some more community-based coalitions, such as the Texas Drowning Prevention Alliance and then Collins Hope, which is here in Austin. They're both water safety coalitions. And then in addition, which unfortunately they're too numerous to mention, the children's hospitals in Texas operate their own injury prevention and community outreach programs. And I have to say that they are very impressive, and they're very focused on injuries that are locally specific. So they're very attuned to the health needs of a particular region. There are some federal funding sources for the injury prevention programs. These are for the state programs. Texas does allocate a portion of its Title V maternal and child health block grant funding for state injury prevention programs. This money partially or in full funds the Child Fatality Review Team, Safe Riders, the Texas Office for the Prevention of Developmental Disabilities Bicycle Safety Program, as well as Safe Sleep for Babies. And Texas also receives or has used federal transportation funding initially through the Safety Lou, and then its reauthorization MAP 21. They have allocated, or TxDOT has allocated, money received through those federal transportation funding programs for motorcycle safety, motor vehicle occupant protection, and pedestrian and bicycle safety programs. Unfortunately, though, even with the money that is being spent, Texas has one of the lowest per capita spending amounts on injury prevention programs. It's at about 17 cents per person. And finally, coming to the recommendations section, there were five recommendations that were developed in the report. One was reestablishing a comprehensive injury prevention center at DSHS. There was an injury prevention center at the old Texas Department of Health, but unfortunately, in subsequent reorganizations of the health agencies, that department or that center vanished, and the functions that are devoted to injury prevention have been somewhat split. Establishing a state-level coalition of hospitals and injury prevention organizations, that was something, in complement to actually establishing a comprehensive injury prevention center, that was, one of the recommendations. It is, of course, administratively intensive. However, I think, as other folks have noted, that there may not be as much coordination on the programs as there could be. Developing best practices for injury prevention, program development, implementation, and evaluation, looking to evidence-based models for injury prevention and trying to implement those and expand those from the hospitals where they're currently being used. Establishing stronger working relationships with medical professional organizations, industry groups, insurance companies, et cetera, to help grow injury prevention programs. These are the folks who are interacting with, consumers and people who use the health, use health services. They can certainly be a conduit for providing information. And finally, developing an injury prevention guide for policymakers at the state and local level to raise awareness of the prevalence of preventable injuries. I know that the Injury Prevention Center of Dallas did put together such a guide, but potentially having other organizations, contribute to the production of this could potentially be helpful, at least for providing to legislators, providing to, folks in the community. And that that concludes my remarks, and I'd like to open it up for questions.
So I would make a couple of comments, and one of the things that Erin did not mention, which I thought was an important finding in her report, was we have some terrific local programs out there. I mean, there are a lot of really dedicated people doing some really neat things around the state, but because it's so locally based, we have a lot of gaps. And we have a lot of opportunities to learn from one another with these strong local programs. As well. So, while there are holes, we definitely have some strong bases to work from. Our desire in this is really, I'd say, start a conversation, but there's been a conversation, but really kind of intensify the conversation over the next few months. Try to disseminate this report to more groups who have an interest in injury prevention, and then try to talk to some of the key stakeholders before the legislative session about whether there's some consensus about what we might do going forward with recommendations about state government, as well as finding some ways to maybe work informally in a collaboration that can do some things, do some advocacy that state government agencies simply can't do by the restrictions on state government. So we really appreciate the opportunity to be here today. We've talked to some other groups as well, and are going to try to keep on doing this through the fall, and happy to answer, have Aaron answer any questions.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, actually, I have a couple, and let me just start with, I really want to commend CHAT for doing this. I think it was, it's necessary. I know it took a lot of time and effort, Aaron, and I actually read the draft report, so, and I was very excited
Thank
to
you.
See that. So the other thing is that available online, the final report?
I will send you a PDF so you can
okay.
distribute it, but it will be on the CHAT website
okay.
if it's not there already.
Couple of things. I think that the timing is really good because for this to come out, because our committee, and I can't remember if I've shared this with either of you, both of you, the Injury Prevention Committee of GETAC has been working on, as Courtney said, a document that we're going to talk about that's on the agenda for today. So I think that document, the document we've been working on is, as Courtney says, living, breathing. It's not, this is at the end all be all. We look to update it as necessary. But I think that that could serve one of the recommendations, and it probably does. We've tried to make it and get as much input as possible, but there's probably others that could provide input and also make it a stronger document. So I think the timing is good for that. The other thing is we are, GETAC and all GETAC committees have been in the process of reviewing the 2002 Texas EMS and Trauma Strategic Plan, and so we're making comments. And again, our committee met in July and came up with some recommendations that we'll present to the GETAC Council on Friday. But I think that there are we could add some recommendations based on your report. So I think the timing is good, and I think that it's critical that we do coordinate, collaborate, and get as much buy-in and input as possible. Committee members, do you have any questions for Aaron or Brian or comments?
Thank you. And thank you for adding to it. I appreciate it.
I have a question, Aaron.
Sure,
you said that Texas has, we are one of the lowest paying states for lowest paying. We only spend 17 cents per person in our state.
Yes.
What is an average amount that's spent across the U.S. just so I can get a ballpark idea of, you know, how low are we? You know?
Well, and what I wonder too, and just to follow up with Mary Ann, is, you know, in comparison with other large states like the Californias, the Illinois, the New Yorks, and the Floridas, how do we compare there? I mean,
sure.
We may not be the same as like Louisiana mm-hmm. because Texas looks different than Louisiana. But
sure, that's true. And I would probably refer you to the actual report that I pulled that from, which was a Safe States report on funding. They focused on really a variety of issues, funding issues associated, looking at federal agencies that tend to partner with state governments, also looking at the different funding levels as well. So I would direct you to that. That's where I pulled it from. And I believe okay. It was the Safe States. I'd have to go back and check, but I can certainly.
It's okay. cited in the report.
It's cited in the report,
okay.
Certainly.
Thank
so you.
Can we'll look at that. All of the members on this committee are members of Safe States, and I'm sitting here thinking, which Safe States report
trying
is that?
Yeah, I was trying to pull it up in my head, yeah.
Well, so. And Aaron, do you know, did they, so I'm guessing that they divided it up by state, so it's.
They did, yes.
Okay.
So you can look per state and see which are the highest spenders and then which are the lowest spenders as
okay.
well.
Colin, do you have a?
Thank you. That's great.
Are there any questions from the audience for Aaron or Brian? Well, if not, I what I'm thinking is, what should our next steps be? And I think that you put in a lot of work, and we would like to use that information. And so maybe our next step is trying to schedule a meeting of this committee with you guys to talk about what should next steps be. How should GETAC, the Injury Prevention Committee of GETAC, use this?
I think we can stay in touch this fall. Like I said, we're going to try to reach out to different groups and then if try to convene some larger discussion when we have identified enough interested people to talk about what to do next. So, yeah, we'll continue the conversation.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, this is probably not on the agenda that you all have, but it's on my agenda, and so I'm not sure why I didn't get on the GETAC agenda, but I've asked Courtney to talk about, there's been some discussion among this committee regarding a CDC program called STEADY, which is Stopping Elderly Accidents, Deaths, and Injuries. Courtney actually implemented the CDC STEADY program within the trauma department at Parkland, has some good evaluation data from that. I think this is probably 1 year of evaluation data, and she's talked about trying to update it as because I believe they're now in year two. Courtney has taken this show on the road and has presented it at the Texas ENA injury prevention meeting. She's presented it at the Safe States meeting in May of this year. And she's also been talking to other departments within Parkland, particularly the geriatrics department. But I think this is an excellent example of taking something off of the shelf from CDC and actually implementing it. I'm not sure that CDC had the idea. I think they thought that it would be implemented more in like primary care clinics and things like that. I think Courtney was thinking a little outside the box when she decided to implement it within the trauma department. But I like, I think she's done a good job in the presentation of describing what CDC has asked for, how they did that at Parkland, and some of the relationships that she had and some of the other departments she had to work with within Parkland to get this implemented. So, Courtney?
Okay, thank you. So this is a program that we implemented. You all know the statistics. The one of the things that's pretty important, and that's kind of how we targeted it, is that a majority of the adults that do fall, the older adults that fall, don't talk about it with their healthcare providers. This is something, it's kind of stigmatized in their mindset. They are afraid that if they let their healthcare providers know that they are falling, that their independence will be taken away. So with that, you know, we've kind of got a captured audience. They've already fallen. They've already got an injury. So we've taken these individuals and we're working with them. So we have used the spectrum of prevention within the trauma center to focus on older adult falls, which is our second leading mechanism, falls in general. For our community or our patient population. And so STEADY became a part of that process in approaching injury prevention for older adult falls and what we do to try to work and eliminate that. So STEADY is Stopping Elderly Accidents, Deaths, and Injuries. It was a toolkit that was designed by CDC. And like Shelley said, it was geared primarily in implementation in community health settings through the independent providers, through their primary care physicians, through those type of mechanisms, and wasn't really meant or designed for the hospital-based situation. But the concepts are there. And so what we did was we took the algorithm that was based on some national and international research and looked at the algorithm and looked at the key factors of what the algorithm was trying to drill down the provider and the patient interaction towards and figured out how we could address that in acute care setting, in a setting where we already have that captive audience and we know that they have already fallen and sustained injury. So there's 11 aspects, really, to the STEADY program and concepts that we went through. And integrating that fall prevention into your holistic practice and approaching these patients. So the first was screening all older adults or all patients for falls. Well, we've kind of already done that for a trauma center because they've already been activated. EMS has already identified that, or when they present through triage, we've kind of already looked at that. But what we did, and CDC, one of their recommendations, was a brochure that they created called Staying Independent that asked those questions to try to get that conversation going. So what we did is we took some of the evidence-based factors that contribute to falls or that are known to contribute to falls or may be linked to contributing to falls, and we added that information into our electronic medical record to really drill down what was going on when this patient did fall, what factors were in play, what was going on, Where did the fall occur to really get that information? Because one, it's fresh in the people's minds. We have EMS there that was actually on scene and saw the environment and saw what happened. We have family members that can be there to give us that information. And so that way it can plan for future training and education with that patient. The second aspect was identifying modifiable fall risk factors. So once again, it's taking that and starting that fall history, starting that conversation. So looking at our mechanism of injury review, part of what we do is this information follows the patient throughout their hospital stay. It's a document with their, it's on their trauma flow sheet that people can see and people can review and know exactly what led up to that. This information, when these patients are discharged and if they fall into our community paramedic program, this information is also relayed to their follow-up care so that we can follow up on, are these situations, if you know it's a lighting issue, not having a nightlight, or climbing up onto a ladder to fix the roof, okay? Are these issues being addressed to try to stem that repeat behavior that may occur? The third component was evaluating gait, lower body strength and balance, and address any identified issues. The CDC recommended the time, the tug test, the 30-second chair stand or a balance test. What we did is those patients that are older adults that are admitted, they get on their admission order set. We have an order for physical medicine and rehabilitation. That order is default selected on their admission order set, so that way they get that consult placed immediately. So it's not something that could be lost or dropped through the system or maybe possibly overlooked, or the patient gets discharged the next day before PM&R may be able to see them. So we place that on admission. With the PM&R evaluation consult has to be completed. We have to implement any recommendations that they have prior to that being a safe and complete discharge. And part of PM&R's evaluation is the tug test. That's built into it. But if they need assistive devices at home to help with their mobility, we get those in place before they're discharged. We also conduct the focus physical exam to address modifiable risk factors. So CDC recommended, in addition to the customary medical exam, to assess specifically muscle tone, cognitive impairment, depression, footwear. So what we did is we have, you know, just as in all trauma centers, we have our tertiary trauma exam. This is completed, you know, once the patient's upstairs, things have calmed down, see if they have new aches and pains. It's completed by our advanced practice providers. So this is completed in addition to our physical medicine and rehabilitation. So PM&R is focusing on their footwear, talking to them about their footwear, making sure that they have non-skid shoes in place before their discharge. That's looked at also. But we're also trying to figure out with that tertiary exam, do we find any other problems that might be contributing to this with orthostatic hypotension, their muscle tone, a fear of falling that may have already been in place. Our screening and brief intervention and referral to treatment. We have a shocking number of older adults whose falls are contributed to substance use or abuse, depending on how you look at it. So 7% of our older adult falls are intoxicated at the time of the event. So we've incorporated with the ESPERT a mental health screen that also assesses for depression in these individuals, and that is completed on all of them before they are discharged. So the postural hypotension, CDC has lots of information about it, focusing primarily on the medication review and just informational about postural hypotension. This is part of our routine nursing care on the floor when they're admitted. We do the medication review with our pharmacist co-partners, and then our advanced practice providers will also complete a medication review. The medication review that's completed by our advanced practice providers, we use the BEERS assessment. The BEERS assessment was created by the American Geriatric Society. And what it really focuses on is medications that should not be prescribed to an older adult, medications that are known to cause problems through metabolism and whatnot. So it's really focusing on deprescribing information and deprescribing medications. So we focus on those more and look at our pharmacy counterparts to really help us coordinate and review all the vast medications that they have there as well. Also part of some of this medication management that we're working on with our older adults that's relatively new and that we're still trying to finesse and work through is getting some of our patients that might be chronic fallers, working with their cardiologists in converting them back to Coumadin off of other medications that might be out there. Because we are, you know, the trauma world is dealing with these different medications that interrupt with a clotting cascade that are leading to significant injuries. And there's nothing as healthcare providers that we can do if they sustain a bleeding event while on these medications. Whereas at least with Coumadin, yes, it's more time consuming, but if they're already following up with their providers, this is a better option for them should they do sustain an injury. Also, increasing the vitamin D so that when they do have a fall event, it's not as significant again, because you know, if they've fallen once, the likelihood of them repeating that fall is more significant. So this is placed on our admission order set as well. This is not one of the defaulted selections. This is where, shockingly, I got the most pushback from my surgeons in that I was prescribing too much of their clinical practice to them and not giving them the option to use their medical management with our injury prevention recommendations. So it's available, it's there, it's looking them in the face, but it's not automatically defaulted for them, or in the renal dosing adjustments are not defaulted for them. But it's reviewed by the advanced practice providers and our trauma nurse clinicians. So if the patient's not on vitamin D, they're asking the providers, why are you making this decision not to have them on vitamin D and or calcium? Is there a reason behind this? To try to get them really to think critically about that decision and change that decision if necessary. Visual acuity and optimizing vision. This is one of the other things, having ophthalmology available, but making sure that it's not just ophthalmology available, come back and, you know, when you're discharged from the hospital next week, as so many other consults are, because most of the time this is not an acute issue. But working with our ophthalmology partners so that these patients will be seen in-house at that time, so they don't have to, we don't have to arrange transport for that older adult and take time and make it a little more cumbersome for them. They're there, they're a captive audience. Let's get them into the clinic, let's get them seen now, get them what they need, their prescription, so that they can move on and forward and we can eliminate that repeat visit back to the hospital or back to another physician. Addressing home safety and how to reduce fall hazards. So once again, this is where the providers are looking at that information that was documented on the trauma flow sheet regarding their fall and all the details. We are, physical medicine and rehabilitation is really working on focusing how to transition from a lying to a standing position, home safety, how to reduce those hazards. With the community paramedic program, we created a home assessment checklist. And information on that checklist is not just necessarily about the environment, but it's also some behavioral-based questionings. Do they turn on a light when they get up in the night to go to the bathroom? Do they wear long sleeves? We're a burn center as well. So do they wear long sleeves, loose sleeves when they're cooking to try to get them to change and process some of that behavioral, as well as the strict environment with throw rugs and clutter and grab bars and lighting and safe hallways. Educating our patients about what causes falls and how to prevent them. So this is where the brunt of the education falls on our advanced practice providers and our trauma nurse clinicians. We created a brochure separate from what the CDC had available. It's called Fall Prevention. But what we did with this brochure is try to make it a little less stigmatizing. So when you open up this brochure, you'll find information in there about pediatric falls. We are not a pediatric center. We don't see pediatrics. But we know that they have grandchildren and kids fall as well. So there's some information about pediatric falls in there because people will sometimes do more for others than they will for themselves. And those same requests cover both the lines with kids and also adults. We also have information in there about things that they can do to make it safe, places that they can go. One of the things that we also will do to adjust our terminology is if we see reluctance on the patient talking to us and confiding in us about their fall event, we now have new terminology that is acceptable and that's used. And so if we see that patient kind of relinquish about that, we call it an unplanned descent to the floor. So we'll talk to the patient, and we talk to their family members in regards to this unplanned descent to the floor. Because it reduces some of that stigma associated with a fall. And we end up seeing that they open up more to us and talk to us. So this document's given to them on their post-call or their post-admission day. It's used repeatedly. People write in it. People document in it. We write their blood pressures in it. And it's referred to throughout their hospital stay. So it is incorporated, and it's not just a piece of paper that's given to them that they put with the other stacks of paper that they're given. So we pull it back and focus on it. Identifying community exercise and fall prevention programs, outpatient therapies is recommended. Our community paramedics really play into this. They have a resource list. We have a resource list. But getting those patients information as to where they can go for Tai Chi, for water therapy, for community events at the senior center, those kind of things to help with that strength building in moving forward. So what we saw with our results was prior to steady, 10% of our mechanisms, of our fall mechanisms, were over the age of 65. And it's for those over 65, falls was our leading mechanism of injury with 65% of them. Average age for both prior to implementation and post-implementation was the exact same in these individuals, and our statistics are the exact same. Our injury severity score, the average actually increased after steady. We started to see a greater number of various extremity injuries. That was the one that fell out that helped bump up that average ISS, but both indicated moderate injury. Our length of stay, this is where, well, we haven't been able to demonstrate reduced number of falls yet. I don't necessarily anticipate that happening since we're, you know, the audience that we're focusing on. That's why we're trying to work with our geriatric clinics to help with the, before they fall and get to us, because we're working with an audience that has already fallen. But what we have been able to do is reduce their length of stay. We reduced their length of stay by almost a day and a half in our older adults. And that is money. That is one, getting them back into the community, getting them out of the hospital where they're at risk for different complications, different problems, getting back in their community and saving money. We also were able to discharge a greater percentage of those patients to their home and get them back in their home instead of trying to find a nursing home or a skilled rehab facility, an LTAC or whatnot for these individuals to go to. So through the aggressive treatments with PM&R and physical therapy, this is what we've been able to demonstrate. So we do have some cost savings in that. Some of the other unintended outcomes from steady, if you go to the hospital now and talk about steady, the staff, you know, any institution has high turnover. We've been doing this. We have one full year of data post-implementation. Our second year of data just completed the end of June. So we're working on closing out all those records and processing year two of data. But they all kind of look at you funny, like, what are you talking about? And we tried to make this program as much of a passive program as possible, where it doesn't rely on any one person to make sure that everything is there in place to increase compliance and to make sure all aspects are approached. You try to take away some of that active participation that they have to have and make it more passive, and they'll be more compliant, such as having, you know, PM&R already defaulted in their electronic medical record. Their screening questions as to those risk factors of falls are already listed for them, and they just have to go through and answer the questions to give them those cues. So overall, we've got a better knowledge of geriatric trauma and the severity of geriatric trauma in our nurses that are, one, taking care of the patients in the trauma recess space, our residents and our physicians, but also our floor nurses and our physical medicine counterparts have also increased and recognized that. And with that, we've seen advances in some of our clinical practice guidelines. They continue to change and evolve, getting a little more detailed in those clinical practice guidelines or incorporating the things and the aspects of steady that we have implemented. We also have a better integration of services. PM&R was a little resistant at first because they were afraid of the increased workload. I'm consulting on every older adult that we admit. We gave them the numbers beforehand so they had an idea, but it's still scary to them to say that you're gonna see every single one of these patients before they're discharged from the hospital. But what we were able to do is, one, they realized that, you know, that wasn't such an unburdensome barrier to them, with also some of our cost savings and helping expedite these patients discharged home. We were able to justify a second position for PM&R. So they were able to get additional inpatient help for that aspect. Also, our ophthalmology friends were another one. They've been very receptive. They like it. And we get those older adults into their clinic very quickly to be seen that day and get their prescriptions. So we've also approved our communication and our integration with some of these other services. So that's the program. Any questions? We can put it up on the website as part of the meeting items.
And if you're interested in learning more about STEADY, and I don't know if you have that in there or not, the website at CDC, Courtney, there is a website that you can at CDC where you can go and download all of the materials for STEADY.
Yeah, all the material. It's like CDC. It's a complete toolkit that CDC has. They have all the brochures, the documentation. CDC's with their documents, you are free to use them. You can put your hospital logo on it. They just ask that if you're putting your hospital logo on their documents, that you remove the CDC logo. But aside from that, you can use their documents. You can use their resources. It's just taking something that was created with good intent and had the principles of and the evidence-informed strategies on it and modifying it for our situation, the acute care setting, and meeting the course of that.
Any other questions for Courtney? Well, thank you, Courtney. Again, I think this is an excellent example of, like I said earlier, taking a CDC program off the shelf and implementing it and refining it to the needs of your hospital. The other thing that I think that in addition to the fact that they were able to reduce length of stay and increase the number of people who are being discharged home as opposed to a facility is important. But I also think that just the this has now been within 2 years, probably within a year, it's become a standard of care, and so it's been implemented into the culture of a Parkland hospital. So I think that's also a good example. So the next thing on agenda is the thing that we've been alluding to all day and we've been talking about, I guess, for the last 8 months. And I do want to say that I want to commend the people sitting to the left and right of me up here because they have literally spent a lot of time and effort developing, getting input, writing, rewriting, sending it out for more comments, redoing other things. This document that we've been working on for the last, like I said, 8 months, and Stuart, Courtney, Marianne, and Susan have put a lot of time and effort into it, and I am I'm very pleased with the final product. I don't know that this is a final product. It's still in draft form, and I think today we are going to discuss some future potential changes to it. The intent is that we will present this. We will vote on it today as a committee. And we will present this to the GETAC Council for their approval, blessing, whatever, at the November meeting. Just a refresher, and this has been up on, I believe it's been on the TTAF, the draft has been on the TTAF website as well as Kelly Harrell's website. And I don't know if it's still up or not. I think I told them that they could keep it posted until August 15th. So, Brenda, I don't know if you guys still have it up. Or not, but if you would like to, for those who haven't seen it and would like to see a copy, we can make some draft copies available. But this is this committee, as well as the purpose, was to provide or to bring together a group of people from different size hospitals. As well as different organizations. We asked for TTAF representation, TTCF representation, RAC representation, And it started at a meeting in Dallas in January, where we spent about 4 hours coming up with what we felt like would be acceptable pertinent components of a hospital-based injury prevention program. And I don't know if Scott Christopher is in here or not, but he also he spent that day in Dallas with us and had a lot of input into this document, so I want to acknowledge him too. The five component areas we came up with were you need these are not new concepts. The Safe States Alliance has very similar concept components for their state injury programs. We also reviewed the ACS Orange Book document so there are a lot of this comes from those other organizations. So the components are probably not going to be new to anyone, but the five areas that we came up with were: you need to use data to drive your programs. You need to partner with others, other organizations, agencies, businesses within the community. You need to provide some type of formal and continuing education for your injury prevention program coordinator at the hospital. You need to use evidence-informed strategies. And the fifth one is you need to evaluate your processes as well as your strategies and your interventions. This is, as you can see, it's not very long, and this is front and back. The intent was it not become some big cumbersome document that you have to pull off your or that you're going to put in a bookcase and never look at. We wanted it to be easy and readable. We also wanted it to be as pertinent for a level one hospital in Dallas and Fort Worth as it is for a level four hospital in, you know, the panhandle of Texas. So that's why we tried to get as much input as possible. It includes an executive summary. It also includes some, in each of the five component areas, it gives resources. For example, on the section on you need to provide some type of formal training for your injury prevention coordinator. It talks about where are acceptable trainings. On the section that talks about engaging partners, it gives examples of how a hospital actually used partners for an evidence-informed program. So there, it provides a lot of resources as well. It's not just here, go do this, and you have no clue as to how to do it, or you have to do your own research or Google or whatever. I'm very proud of it. And then I think we'll just get started. Stuart, I know you had some suggestions regarding the executive summary, and then I'm just going to go down the row and see if anybody else has things they want to add.
Yeah, in the executive summary, I would just make a suggestion that we add the each one of the components listed early in the document so that there's no table of contents, and I don't think the document is really big enough to really have a table of contents, but to list them in that executive summary I think would be beneficial.
Okay. Courtney, do you have any suggestions, or you've probably looked at it too many times? Courtney pulled it all together for us after.
I do have one other suggestion, and I would move that we on component two, just the importance there is to engage partners for collaboration. And I think it might be helpful for us to shorten the title. And I don't know how others, especially Susan, you're the author of that section. I don't know how you feel about that. It's just a suggestion. I think it gets the title is kind of lengthy and might get a little cumbersome. I don't.
And I would agree with you. I think it could certainly be shortened down to just the major point of the statement, because we cover then in the conversation what we're doing with it, the importance, the need of it.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good point.
Okay.
So Susan and Stuart, are you suggesting that the title then become Engage Partners for Collaboration?
I would.
Yeah, I would move that that's what we do.
I would do too.
Okay. Mary Ann and Courtney, are you guys fine with that? Okay. Mary Ann, do you have any comments or
No, because if I have any more comments, you're going to give me more homework, so no. No, I, seriously, we all, when Shelley says that we all worked very hard on this, it is a very usable, sorry, Stuart, it's a very usable document, and what I really liked about it, as many of you out there are perhaps new to that title of violence and injury prevention coordinator, and you look at your boss and your boss is like, I just need you to do some programs. There is a lot of information in this document that will help you to build a substantial and valuable program to whatever facility you work in, and it's a great tool.
Before Stuart has another suggestion, Susan, do you have any?
No, that's your limit, Stuart. No.
Okay. Stuart?
In component three, not to get too technical here, but under the suggested web-based trainings, the fourth and fifth bullet, there are actual costs associated with those particular organizations. And I was thinking if we put in like $90 a year for the association membership or $85 a year, that really dates the document, where we might be better off just saying there's a member fee applies perhaps for this organization, because that's going to change over time.
That's true.
Okay. I know that you guys aren't sitting here out in the audience, aren't looking at the copies that we have, but are there any questions about this project, about the document, any concerns or any suggestions you may have that to make sure that is included in the document? Any comments from the audience? Okay. Stuart, do you want to mention, I know you serve on the Injury Coalition, the whatever that group is, that national group. Do you want to mention anything about, I know we had talked about trying to get this out there and make it available. Well, I'm speaking specifically to the work group, not the Safe State SIG. You can talk about that too, but to the
Injury Prevention Coalition.
Yes, that.
The Injury Prevention Coalition, I believe, is a coalition that's come together from multiple different organizations. AATC, is that right? I believe I forget all the acronyms. Excuse me. Thank you. Got the two A's right. The Injury Prevention Coalition, they're having an inaugural meeting in September. I believe this meeting is the 9th and 10th in Philadelphia. There's information, there's flyers that have gone out. I don't know if others are interested in the audience in that particular Injury Prevention Coalition meeting. It is open to injury prevention managers, injury prevention coordinators, trauma managers, et cetera. So we can provide the information of that meeting. I know it's kind of a short notice. It's right around the corner in September, but I will be attending that meeting on behalf of Safe States Alliance and providing some representation there, and be happy to bring back any information I can about the injury prevention discussions that take place there.
Okay. All right. Are we ready for a? I probably need a motion regarding accepting this with changes.
I'll make a motion that we accept the hospital-based injury prevention, components document with the noted changes that we've just discussed.
Okay. Second?
Second it.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed? Okay. We will, I will update the GTAC Council on Friday to look for this in their November meeting packet. So, and again, thank you guys for this. The next agenda item is we had a meeting in Fort Worth on July the 25th to discuss any updates, recommendations that the Injury Prevention Committee would want to make to the Texas EMS and Trauma Strategic Plan. And we came up with about 3 pages worth of objectives and suggested strategies. I can make those available to the audience. What I think I may do is ask each of the committee members have it in front of them. So I might ask maybe each of us to just read some of that so that the audience knows what some of our we came up with six objectives, and the objectives all are align with the level of the spectrum of prevention. And so each objective there will be an objective on policy, there will be an objective about organizational change, there will be an objective about providing education to providers, et cetera, et cetera. And then with those objectives, we made recommendations for what some of the activities could be. So, Stuart, if you'd start and read objective one and the activities, or summarize. You don't have to read it word for word, but
objective one is listed currently as identifying opportunities for policy advancements and legislative initiatives to impact and prevent injuries and violence within the state of Texas. Some of the activities that are listed is working with the appropriate liaisons to develop trauma and injury prevention policy agenda and have that promoted during the Texas legislative sessions, providing education to the stakeholders about the legislative process and how to be a legislative advocate, building relationships with legislative aides to be the go-to resource for expert opinion, et cetera. Partnering with the Department of State Health Services to create and disseminate an annual resource for policymakers, which might include pertinent injury data, the top 5 causes within Texas, perhaps current injury and violence prevention status in Texas, how Texas ranks nationally, and then information about known evidence-based strategies, really making it a guide for legislators to have all the information at their hands around those top 5 or whatever we would decide would be the ones that we want to highlight for that particular legislative session. Explore opportunities to fund a designated injury and violence prevention department within Department of State Health Services, and develop and maintain a list of legislators and include the committee assignments that impact injury and violence prevention.
Okay. Courtney, you want to do objective 2?
Sure. Objective 2 is to incorporate safety and injury prevention into the fabric of organizational culture and operations. Some of the activities are to work with Texas funding agencies and organizations to disseminate injury prevention funding that seeks to modify behavior by appropriating funds for evidence, informed environmental or policy changes rather than just educational strategies, to identify or develop a toolkit to assist state local agencies in developing a health and safety in all policies approach to addressing prevention of health and safety issues, and provide access to evidence-based and evidence-informed injury prevention strategies to increase an organization's capacity to create a health and safety culture, creating a forum for sharing the best practices and success stories within organizations, develop and disseminate toolkits, specific, you know, one that was mentioned was the Intimate Partner Violence Toolkit for Texas workplaces, and then information on how to build environments and communities, safe and walkable neighborhoods, for example, that also can produce active residents that reduce chronic diseases, etc.
Okay. Marianne, you want to do number 3?
Number 3 is facilitate collaboration among injury prevention professionals and advocates in the state. So some things that we can do for that is to sponsor a Texas Injury and Violence Prevention Summit every couple of years, work with DSHES to develop injury and violence prevention online resources that allows each of our own organizations to post what specific areas, what specific things that we have going on, align it to geographic regions, have contact information online.
compile and maintain a list of known national and state injury and violence prevention organizations. There are so many of those out there. I'm always running across a new one. And so it would be nice if we had a giant list that would have to be updated a lot. To develop cohesive tools to unify efforts of injury and violence prevention professionals and advocates.
Objective 4 is to enhance the knowledge and skills of the Texas injury prevention workforce. Some of the activities that we are suggesting would be to sponsor a Texas Injury and Violence Prevention Summit every couple of years, work with appropriate trauma providers to provide the workshops and sessions at other existing conferences, serve as a knowledge broker or clearinghouse for information, and create a forum for sharing best practices of the information and success stories.
It, I'll read objectives 5 and 6, and you will notice that some of the activities that are maybe mentioned in one objective are also pertinent to another objective. So we felt like it was important to list it twice, such as sponsoring the Injury and Violence Prevention Conference or Summit. Objective 5 is elevate the awareness and need for injury and violence prevention in the state of Texas. Some of the recommendations are collaborate with DSHS to support and develop an annual report for the dissemination of injury and violence data to a broad range of stakeholders, and utilize that annual report to benchmark comparisons to similar states and other states and national rates. Develop a broad, interactive, and timely social media campaigns that align with data to address specific injury issues, which can be used on a regular and opportunistic basis. Objective 6 is provide access to evidence-informed injury prevention strategies to increase an individual's capacity for a safe and healthy lifestyle in Texas. And some of the activities that would be used to accomplish that objective: serve as a knowledge broker clearinghouse for injury and violence-related information, utilize social media to educate individuals and families about ways to prevent injuries and violence, and collaborate with DSHS to support and develop an annual report. So those are some of the recommendations that we came up with. We will be presenting our suggestions to the GETAC Council for their consideration. And just in reviewing them again, we came up with these ideas back in July, and after hearing Aaron and Brian's report about the Children's Hospital Association of Texas study that they did, it looks like some of the recommendations overlap. So I don't know if that's great minds think alike or I don't know. Are there any comments from the audience regarding the suggestions? Any suggestions that you have, any concerns that you have about our suggested objectives and activities? Okay. Either we're doing an outstanding job or it's 2 o'clock after a big meal and everybody's tired. Okay.
Well, okay. I have a comment. If you heard some of those, was to talk about developing an annual report, to talk to legislators, to talk to people that we just hang out with. In the TTAF meeting last night, it was brought up about people talking about cancer all the time, or we see commercials about heart disease, and we don't think anything else. We go, oh yeah, we need to prevent that. I need to go, take this pill or eat this food, but we don't talk about per se. We'll talk about, gosh, if you're in a car crash, you are going to look awful and be mangled up. But we don't talk about, if you're in a car crash and you have a seatbelt on, how that you will probably be able to go to work next week. We don't talk about the positive side of trauma. And I think sometimes part of this whole strategy, a lot of it is focusing on the positive. And as trauma professionals, whether you're injury prevention or your data or your whatever, we all should be working together toward a positive, putting it out there within our own community so we can begin to change the social norm of what trauma is and what it is that we do and how we try to prevent. So maybe, you know, in a couple of years, we can all be looking for jobs somewhere else. But I think this strategy really addresses that. And again, great minds think alike, along with the TTAF people. So maybe we all are coming to an interesting point in trauma history.
Thanks, Marianne. Okay, I don't think we don't need to take a vote on this, so we'll just provide this to the GETAC Council for their consideration. Next thing on the agenda is general public comment. Any general public comment?
Hi, I'm Erin Cater with the DSHS EMS Trauma Registry, and at the last GTAC, a drowning report was requested, and I just wanted to give an update. That report is now on our website, along with a few other new reports, and if you have any questions about or feedback on any of these reports, please let us know.
Okay, thank you very much, Erin.
That's excellent.
Announcements? I have a few, but I'll let the committee. Do you have any announcements, Stuart, sir? Courtney?
No.
Marianne? Your trauma conference?
Oh. JPS is having our fourth annual trauma symposium on October the 24th. It will be on the JPS website by next week. And we have quite a few nationally known speakers, including Thomas Scalia, other speakers from Tulane University, Johns Hopkins, and Shock Trauma. We would love for you all to come to downtown Fort Worth, to Tarrant County College, Trinity River campus, and spend the day with us. We'll feed you very well all day long. You will get about 7 CEs. Both nursing and medical CEs will be provided.
Susan? Okay, I have a few announcements. The first thing is that this is August, and I believe September 1 through September 30th, there will be an opportunity to apply to be a member of the GTAC Injury Prevention Committee. I think that's correct, right, Jane?
Actually, the first is Labor Day.
Oh, okay.
So the application will go up on our website on the 2nd.
Okay. And currently we have, I think, four openings that people have been in the position and had to leave for some reason. So we've got four openings to begin with. So there's a if you apply, there's a pretty good chance you may get selected. One of the things that I think GTAC likes to look at is diversity in terms of geographic diversity, just diversity across the board. So if you are interested and you are from a rural or frontier area, we'd certainly encourage you to apply. But if you're also from an urban area, we don't want to say we've got too many urban people, because I think we've got a pretty good group up here right now. So if you know someone or if you are interested in being on the Injury Prevention Committee, be looking look at the GTAC website sometime early September, and I believe you'll have about 30 days to get that in. Those decisions are usually made in October for the new committee members. So I encourage you to do that. Just a couple of other, there are the Society for the Advancement of Violence and Injury Research. It's a national research association, but they will be having their, they don't meet annually, but I think they meet every other year. Their next meeting is planned for mid-March, and I can get those dates to you, but it will be held in New Orleans mid-March. Right before that, Lifesavers Traffic Safety Conference is a big national conference. It's literally held the week before the Saver Conference in Chicago. Those are two good opportunities to learn more about injury and violence prevention. Texas is part of a regional injury network that includes as far west as New Mexico, includes the entire southern part of the U.S., and it also includes Tennessee, Kentucky, North Carolina, South Carolina. So it's a pretty large network. They have Their meetings usually are late March, mid to late March to early April. They usually try and move their meetings around so it's they're not always having them in the same place like Atlanta, Georgia, or Chapel Hill, North Carolina. But in 2015, the meeting is going to be in Dallas, Texas. So the dates that we're looking at right now, we're still in the planning phase, but the dates that we're looking at will be April the 6th, all day April, Monday, April the 6th, and half a day on Tuesday, April the 7th. There will not be a registration fee for this, but obviously you would have to travel to Dallas. And typically these meetings are, they try to bring in some different national speakers to highlight different activities, evidence-based or evidence-informed activities that are going on. One of the things that they want to highlight this year because of all of the work that Texas has done regarding the hospital-based injury prevention programs is they're wanting to highlight hospital-based injury prevention programs and probably some of the work that our committee has done. So it'd be a great opportunity to come and learn there. This committee had talked about, we have not had a statewide injury conference or a summit since 2012, and we decided that what we would try to do for the next few years and what we've tried to do is incorporate learning opportunities in existing conferences. Courtney and Stuart presented at I mentioned earlier at the ENA conference, the Texas ENA conference. We're going to talk to, I know the EMS conference for this year has already been planned, but we're going to talk about trying to maybe have get some sessions at the 2015 EMS conference. But we've also talked about other ways that we could provide some learning opportunities, and one of those things that we discussed was potentially providing grand rounds, whether they would be grand rounds here in Austin, and we could do some type of teleconference and broadcast it to other areas. Those are some of the things that are on the table. And so one of the things that we had talked about is maybe trying to even incorporate a grand rounds possibly with the regional network injury meeting in April. So that meeting would be in Dallas, but that we might be trying to do some activities in Austin that week as well. So those are just some announcements that I have. One last chance. Anything else, guys? Okay. We had I can't remember if we canceled it. We did have, at the first of the year, we tentatively set dates for workday meetings. And we had one scheduled for October, but I'm thinking, did we cancel that at the July meeting?
I think we did.
Okay, so we will probably not have a workday meeting during the last quarter of the year, and our regular meeting will be during the EMS conference in Fort Worth in November. So, okay. If there's nothing else, then the Injury Prevention Committee meeting is adjourned.